Hello friends, we are honored to have a very special guest today with us in our program. I welcome Kagitha Laxmi Priya, founding member of Cheyutha, a women community-based organization which is based in Hyderabad. Laxmi Priya, can you please share your lived experience of your journey with HIV? Over to you.
It's a privilege for me to ask to share about my experience. Being in a HIV positive, there is lot of we need to discuss, madam, because this is not one word or one day to go, because this is a long struggle and a battle of women existing with HIV and being on a widow, single mother. It's not easy for a woman to raise the children and take care of her health. Because our community, our organization works for the community who are HIV positive and they are infected through their husbands and partners. Knowingly, unknowingly, children are being infected with HIV also. And there is a lot of struggle. The story you can find same story as organization is supporting women here. The similar stories are same like that, because being in a positive
we can't hear you
along with the children and all, and where the woman goes into a lot of struggle to get her life into, kind of existing for her in the society will be a big challenging for her.
Yes.
Ma'am, actually there's a disturbance going on here.
That is all right. That is all right. Please continue.
Just a second. Ma'am, do you want me the video of mine or how it is?
It would be good if we can see you, but it's up to you. It would be good if we can see you.
Just a second, ma'am. Our second line leader is making all this help for me.
Yes.
Ma'am, there's a problem with the video.
Okay.
We'll go with an audio only.
Okay, okay, but can we begin again, Lakshmi? Can we begin again? Can we? I can just ask you again. Let us begin it again because friends, we are really honored to have a very special guest today with us in our program. I welcome Kagitha Laxmi Priya, founding member of Cheyutha, a women community-based organization. And we have a lot to learn from Laxmi. So welcome, Laxmi Priya. And can you please share your experience, your personal experience of your journey with HIV? And then we will come to your organization.
Yeah, ma'am. Actually, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Laxmi Priya. I'm working as a project director for Cheyutha Women Community-Based Organization. This is based at Hyderabad. We work for two districts, Hyderabad and Rangareddy, for Telangana state. And as ma'am was asking to share my experience, so my experience, you need to have a patience of hearing 23 years story and 19 years struggle of my into the organization. I come from a family where we have a five elder sisters and two disability brothers, and I am the youngest in the family. And I got married in 97, and I've seen my worst life, the second life of mine. As soon as my marriage, I had lot of health issues, and till 6 months I was completely on bed. And after that, my father expired in 98, and my mother expired in 99, and during that year we came to know that I was carrying my pregnancy. And during the pregnancy time till 7th month, doctors were seeing for a regular checkup, but they haven't insisted for going for HIV testing. So during that time, in the 7th month, they have given a routine test, and there my husband has went and collected the reports, and he brought all the reports were safe and for me to get delivered. And I don't know, some discussion was going in the family. I was not aware of it. And it was in a phone call discussing with my husband's elder brother and my father-in-law. And later, during my 8 months of starting this thing month only, my husband told that I need to discuss with you regarding your delivery. Then I thought that I don't have parents, so I thought my husband is taking care of my delivery. So I just asked him what happened. Means he told that he closed all the doors, and he came and told that I am only HIV positive. During the pregnancy time, during that day, if you know that you are HIV positive, you have AIDS, means you're going to die. There is no medicine for you. And how could a pregnant mother can digest this news? And I was being kind of tension. I don't know what was going on with me. I was crying. All these emotions were surrounded with me. And I asked him why this one had come to me, because during my education, I used to educate my mother that my mother was a diabetic patient, and she used to go for insulin injections. So we had an ad in the TV saying that we have to use disposable syringes while taking injections and all. So we never had a blood contaminate, like no blood transmission. No, before my marriage, I was not, I was very well healthy and that time. So why will I get this HIV? So I don't have anywhere connection with that. So my husband told, no, we have to go and meet the doctor in the evening. So when I went there, I asked, Madam, what is this? All reports, my husband is saying that you are HIV positive. Means I'm told that HIV means, HIV means AIDS, and you're going to, there's no treatment for that, she told. You're going to die very early. Then I told, if I'm going to die very early, then what's the meaning of having this baby? So why don't you abort it? because there is no medicine and we are going to die early. We don't want to see suffering children in front of our eyes. Every mother during her pregnancy, she will think that she have to have a healthy baby. And that is what even I also feel as a woman. But doctors told that no, you have you have AIDS and you're going to die, and we can't conduct your delivery at our hospital, because if we conduct your delivery at this hospital, our hospital is going to shut down. And they just, without no courtesy, they have referred me to government hospital, where I took all my documents and went. I was into depression. I was not understanding whom to talk, whom to tell, where to go. All those there was only tears in my eyes. It was continuously crying. And when I went in a line, I stood there showing my all papers, and doctors told that seeing my HIV report, they throwed all papers on my face and told that you are HIV positive. Why did you come here to infect all of us? Then when they have told me this word, I felt that I don't know how I become positive, but people are blaming me in such a way that I am coming here to infect everyone. I don't have rights to infect anyone, right? So I told, if the people are facing problem with me and my HIV status, I have no meaning in surviving this life for a few days also. So I thought, whatever it comes on my way, I want to die. So I just walked on the main road, whatever it is coming, I'll just go in front of lorry or bus, anything. I want to go and suicide along with my baby. But suddenly my husband walked beside me and he said that, if I'm having, only you are having this HIV, he said. I just stood a second on the road. I said that, if you know about your status, why didn't you tell us before the marriage, or if you are having any problem with your family, you could have told me, well, at least while planning for the children, and I couldn't have gone for this pregnancy. So my husband has no answer for my question, and we have gone home. I cried so much. I have been very faithful to my partner, and he hasn't turned partner faithful to me. So this is what going on, and I don't, if I'm continuously crying like this, who is going to take care of my delivery part? Because delivery part wasn't a challenge for me, because no one is touching me that time. And whom to go and tell about my issues, because no parents for me. If my elder sisters come to know, how they will treat me? That was a fear which was going on with me. But finally, I just decided in my bad situation that if I am keep on crying, no one is going to help me out, and this is almost all out of my hand right now. So what should I want to do is that I have to do. And I got so few ICU materials from that government hospital. So I've just gone through that. I just wanted to understand that, what was HIV, what was AIDS, how will the people get that, what is the survival of the lifetime, and what is the medication available. All these things I was just reading, and not two lines there was written that if you go for a C-section and stop breast milk and prevent newborn babies. So that was a major hope I got there, and I just spoke to my husband. I told, what has happened is happened, now let us see what you have to do further, because I should get delivered, and not only delivered, I should also protect my newborn baby, because I don't want to see my child suffering in my front of my eyes, and there's no meaning in surviving. So he told, okay, we'll go for C-section. And we have gone through all Hyderabad hospitals. No one has come forward. All were asking, before marriage, you had any sexual relations, or after marriage, and what is your husband? And this sort of things was going, asking me. But no one came out to support me. So finally, one hospital has agreed for my delivery, and they told, if you're getting normal pains, you come, we'll do your delivery. I told doctor that normal delivery is the not the thing, ma'am. I want to give a birth to the newborn baby who I don't want my baby to get transmitted this HIV. Then there's a God for us who's looking after us and understood my problem. And there was a pediatrician doctor who came from another room, and he told, why are you so much worried? There's one hospital who's conducting the deliveries. Why didn't you go and approach them? Then he gave me address, and I went to New City Hospital at Secunderabad area, where ma'am also asked me several questions. I answered her, and she agreed to do delivery, but she told it would be a very expensive. For us, during that time, 50,000 was a very expensive delivery for us. So whatever gift I got, the jewelry gift from my father, I sold all those and I got delivered. So struggle part is one, that one phase. And the second phase was, during my, I had so much of milk to feed my baby as a woman, right? So that unfortunate, I feel today also I'm very unfortunate. I couldn't feed my baby during her hunger time. So, and I have gone through a lot of pain, and I was having so much milk. When the baby used to cry, all the milk used to come out. As a mother, as a woman, I cried so much. And all those 6 months of delivery, my life is to be surrounded with complete darkness. Knowing that you are positive, you are going to die, what you will do with the baby, how your husband, what he is. And this was the things going on, nothing was there in the brain. And finally, my husband, when my baby was 6 months old, he had TB, meningitis, weight loss, diarrhea, and a lot of infections. And during that time, doctors used to read the books and give antibiotics. And that's how we have lost him in the 2001 January. And that time, when I was serving him in the hospital, I never had food to eat. I don't have medicine to put anything. And I had started having all infections in me. And when my daughter reached to 1.5 year baby, and that time for me to cook some food for her also was a challenging thing. So she used to help me to catch my ring finger and take me there to cook some food and feed her. And that was the thing. And my sisters came to know that I am positive. My brother-in-laws never supported me. They used to beat my sisters. Your sister might have done some wrong and all. So this was the thing going on. Then I decided myself that my husband might have done some mistake. He got the infection, and from there I got it. And why should my sisters face all those? So when this is my fight, and I have to fight for myself. And I told my sisters, actually there was a pack medicine in Hyderabad saying that there is cure for HIV. And my sisters all contributed 10,000. They gave me the medicines, thinking that if I'll become negative, I'll be surviving for my daughter. But unfortunately, what happened, the doctor had called one of my sister and told that, you know how your sister might have got HIV? Because she might have done some sex work and all. So your family might have be comes from the sex worker's family only. Why don't you have come for one night to my place? And this, when my sister told me, actually hers was long marriage. She belongs to a Brahmin community. And the people, when they told my sister was crying so much, and she told that this is a one, he asked that fellow. Then I told I will not take further medicine also, because there was no money with me. More 30,000 where I have to pay for him and take medicine. I don't have money with me, so this is my fight. I am going to fight. And I told my family members not to involve in my health issues. Even to buy a glass of milk was a challenging to me, madam, to my daughter. So my sister used to give some 500 rupees. I used to save that money. If I cook some rice in the morning, I used to check whether I'll have rice to eat in the evening or not. So all these things were going on. And later, some organizations have registered us as a CBO members, and they told that we'll go get 9 lakhs budget for us. I told HIV AIDS means people never touched us, and who will give us? And finally, I was so much lucky enough to meet Dr. Ranganath Rao sir in my life. He is my godfather. He is everything to me. He is so much kind of a guidance he has given, the support he has given to me, that is ultimate for me. Today, whatever Priya is doing, some good work at Hyderabad, protecting children, HIV positive children, or the women who are HIV positive, who are going for education, doing positive marriage, legal aid supports, anything, that complete credit goes to Dr. Ranganathan Rao, sir. That is, I just dedicate to him.
When did you meet him first, and how did you come in contact with him?
It was in 2003. Mm-hmm. I used to pray daily to God that I should get some job to feed my daughter, And I once went to Lepra to get some medicines for me. There, they told that leprosy people used to work in that organization. So I thought that these leprosy people are working in this organization, so I might also can get some job here. But I was not getting that channel. But one person who's HIV positive, when my husband was hospitalized, I read about him in the DC Chronicle paper, that Hari Rao. And fortunately, he came to my, there was an organization in front of my mother's apartment, flat. There I met him. I told him, you are Mr. Hari Rao. No, you are HIV positive. I read about you. Sir, I am also suffering with the same thing. He told, I am busy with going to Freedom Foundation. I'll come back to you tomorrow. I'll meet. So whatever food I had, I offered him. And that time, he few organizations, he showed me. And that's how I met Lepra and Dr. Ranganathan Rao, sir. And I just went and told him everything. And he told, okay, ma, you come tomorrow, he said. But my fear, like if I go, today he heard about me. Tomorrow he can ask me to get out of the office also. I was shivering in that way. But to my surprise, he just got up from his chair and came and gave me a hug, ma'am. That is, I will never forget that. And he told, I told, sir, if I'm going to die, please take care of my daughter. What he said that, no, I will not take care of your daughter, I will take care of only you. If you are survive, yes, you can take care of your daughter, he said. So, if you think, ma'am, you don't have a life and you're going to die, there is no meaning of your life.
But you found a savior. See, God sends troubles, but God also sent Dr. Ranga Rao to you.
He is not with me today. He's there in Delhi somewhere, yes, working for Saskar, yes, Foundation and all.
Yes.
But he is my inspiration. He is my whatever I am today. I think that he had guided me properly, and no one will believe anyone, madam, but he had given his whole heart.
Yes.
I was having so much torture from other people also, but he protected me.
Yes.
He never told any day a single word also to me. Yes. He had encouraged me so much.
Yes.
He had given confidence in me, and that's how I could have took this journey smoothly. Though people try to pull you down also,
yes,
he's the one person, he not pull me down. He had understood me completely. And today, till today also, he is supporting our organization with the Adults and Friend Healthy Clinic, who is from 10 to 17 years. He provides support there, and anything I feel, I just call him and talk to him. And not only he is, but madam also, his wife, very much like their parenting to me. They love us. Not only me, madam, that they love our all HIV positive people. So that is missing right now in the society. People, there are cure for leprosy. There is colonies for leprosy, but when you comes to the HIV, no, ma'am, there's lot of burning issues till today. Women are not coming out, children are not coming out. They're simply facing the hardship. And government think that they are doing prevention part, but we are not doing prevention part, man. That's the truth after all. Because many are helpless, some are behavior is not change towards society. They might face some stigma, discrimination. There is no financial support. There is no proper care for the children. So I tell that being a woman and being a mother and being a widow, I always encourage my community people, see, whatever is there in our faith, we have been infected. So let us try, let us keep us try. We shouldn't get infect other people, because the prevention part only can done by a HIV positive person, not by a negative person. So I've been talking all this throughout my life journey and to the children also. And and our organization was registered in, we got this Cheyutha from Lepra Society, where Dr. Ranganath Rao sir had promised me, and he has designed this. I worked 2 years voluntary, madam. I went to all the donor agency partners. I used to beg their feet to get the project, but no one has supported me. Every day morning I used to go, in the evening I used to come back to Dr. Rao sir's table, and I used to cry there. And he told, if no one is supporting, I'm there. I'll talk to Lepra UK people and get you a project. And that was a Hyderabad first PLHIV project. And after seeing our hard work, our State AIDS Control Society, Damyanti Madam IS officer, and Danika Chalam was one of my mentor also. And Mrs. Mekla, who supported me very much. And that's how today Cheyutha is a platform for the women and the children who are suffering like me, madam. And yes, we provide different kind of services, counseling, family counseling, one-to-one counseling. We do also home visits. We have a clinical support here. We provide free opportunistic infections medicine. We have a foster care, like parents who died with the AIDS, and children have been supported with treatment, nutrition, education also. We also have a major support area is for education, because we think that if till the parents are out there, the children have a beautiful life. After father dies or mother dies, then the child is again left on the road. So we don't want to see that children. If they get their education, then they will go back to their schools and all. So the key area we support for education, so that if the children are educated, they can take care of themselves and their families and who are dependent for them. And we have a jute enterprise where we have trained all the women on jute bag making. We have that enterprise, we developed into a sustainability model. It was in 2016. We have inaugurated by the support of APIC, USAID, and Lepra Society. We got this extension with an Indian Red Cross Society also, I should mention here, because those are the people who provided free office space, and for their enterprise also free space we have. Now we have machines there, we make bags, but we are not getting as expected jute orders. So people will call us there. I don't know, people will find some kind of a funny way or a time pass thing, I don't know, but people will call, within 2 days you can make, we have this model, that model. But genuinely, they, no one will support us, madam, because truth, if we talk truth, what is truth means, we will not get support in hospitals. If you know you are HIV positive, you have been for getting your surgery done or treatment, or for standing your blood tests and everything, you have to stand around with the general public in a big queue. And your health also will not support you for a longer time. And that time outreach workers should be guiding them, support them in the hospital when that test is. Till today also we'll face problems in getting HIV positive surgeries. Only few doctors, we have bold doctors who will support the cause, but other doctors will just refer them or ask them to come continuously, where the patient will have lose the confidence in themselves, and they won't come back to the hospitals. And for the jute bag orders also, it's the same thing. We will not get frequent orders. We have one or a few orders like that. But somehow we are able to manage things, ma'am.
So I actually salute you, Laxmi Priya. You are such a brave woman and you are an inspiration to all of us. And your story again brings out that point that the virus does not differentiate between different genders, but people do. And it affects women differently. And you are one of that living testimony. Do you think that this discrimination which is there in society, have things changed for the better since since 2000, during the last 24-25 years? Have you found anything?
Yeah, ma'am, we have found the differences. Like I told you, ma'am, the IS officers who are coming in, they should also have the heart in providing the support for HIV community people, and even the government also should understand. The government are not understanding what other people will support us, madam. So stigma discrimination is, we are telling, we are getting, bringing down the stigma discrimination, but that is not very true. That is directly, indirectly there are people suffering like that. And many of them can't come out and share because media will be exposing. They might have children and where they have to stop their education. They won't give rents for the houses. And people who are HIV positive, man, they come from below poverty line and lower middle class. And those are not even having basic needs like houses, food for two times, education. And the government system, whatever we have, maybe in Hyderabad, in Telangana state, the government school, only few government schools works very good, but few government school doesn't work. And people come from different communities. These people are from the below poverty or lower middle class. People can't adjust with those people. And these are the major things we have to look in.
Okay. What about your daughter? What is she doing now?
Yeah, she finished her degree, BCom Computers, and made sure that she have to have her degree certificate with her, if I'm there or not there. But she had also married.
Okay.
It was a love marriage.
All right.
So I thought that, I don't know, I just planned like if at all a girl is educated and she is financially independent, then whatever she can do by herself. But unfortunately, I don't know what was depression she was undergoing, Nikita, I don't know. But we were not having male in our life at all. So I thought she might wanted a father's love or brother's love, where she was missing so much. And the guy was very good, like they met in a WhatsApp group and all, and within 6 months I came to know that she's in having an affair with this guy, and where I spoke, they come from a very, very below poverty line. Actually, I thought after working for so many years, I thought of taking some rest after she gets married. But again, I have to work very hard for her to have a basic necessity to support her. Because I think somewhere I was leaving her going for a work daily, and my presence was very much during my work, and where I used to get some salary, I used to save some money for her, for education, for her maintenance and everything. At least basic minimum support also we should give to the female girl, ma'am.
Yes.
So that's how I used to decrease all my personal things, and I used to provide for her education, clothes, and proper this thing. But she was not with me for 10 years. I mean, she was studying till class 5 with me, and after class 6 till 10th class, she was in my sister's place because of my work and all. I was not able to take care, but she also faced some misbehavior with my sister's daughter's son-in-law, and which was we should not express to me. I tried to find out from her, but she never told open to me, so that was going on. It's a nightmare, madam.
Yes, I can understand that. So what about your family members? are they now more adjusted towards you, or that discrimination has, stigma has decreased, or what
no,
about
no,
their
madam.
behavior?
Actually, no. I have a responsibility of two disability brothers to take care. Because I am living in my mother's house, so I don't have any option, because I never get rent for a single, because my daughter was studying in her 10th class. I thought of shifting myself to a somewhere place where near to her school, so that I'll be, I will able to see her properly and all. But people, many of them told that we can't give you rent because you're a widow, you're a single mother, don't know how it will be, and I don't get any rent for a house. Then I decided that I should stay back in my mother's house only, where I have two disability brothers where I have to take care. And all my five elder sisters, they used to come to my house. What happened to you? You are looking very healthy or no? You can cook food for us. Take care. So whatever body pains I'm having, they will not understand, no, madam.
Yes.
So I have to work, I have to cook for them, I have to take care of them. So this is all is there. So till today also I'm facing the same things. If I want to sleep for 1 hour also, I can't do that.
Yes.
I have to get up and go.
Yes. So you are very right in pointing out that the status of women and their place in society, in this patriarchal society, is still very, very dismal. HIV or no HIV. Of course, HIV is putting an additional burden on them. And otherwise, also, this, it's a sorry state of affairs. And I really feel very, very concerned about these things. But you are putting a brave front, Laxmi Priya. It's like we have to learn from your example that come what may, we have to keep on fighting, and keep on fighting not only for ourselves, but for others as well. So that is very important. And I'm really grateful you have shared your story, because this sets an example. This gives all of us hope, because, you know, most of us women, they are struggling in their spheres, in their lives, one way or the other. And your inspiration and your work and your bravery and courage, that will give hope, and is giving hope to many, many other women as well. One thing I wanted to ask, you know, we are having this AIDS conference in Munich, in Germany, AIDS 2024. And the theme is put people first. What, according to you, does this mean? Putting people first. What should it entail? How will we put people first?
That caption itself was wrong, madam, for me. Why? Because if you are asking people in front of, not to make some images, photos, or put that we have a board person here, we have a community member here, showing up, why you want to do that things? Show at the grassroots level, no. Show at the people in people at the grassroots level what suffering they are going on, what is the thing, why we are not doing prevention part and all.
Yes. No, I would like you to word it in a different way. What does it, when we say we have to put people first, what should be done actually? When will people be put first? When will people be in the forefront? What should be done for that? Perhaps if you can explain it that way.
Yeah, actually, madam, that's what I'm telling. For making some, I was telling, even we had this kind of a slogans many times in during World AIDS Day theme and all, madam. But my thing is, like, if you want to have a community member in front and tell that they are going to do something, but there is no support given to them.
Okay.
And there's no right people also been chosen. Because there is a national level network of people positive, there is a state level of people positive, where I'm not affiliated to anyone. I'm still working singly. I'm just supported with the well-wishers, with the people who knows me, like Azim Premjit and all, they have come front and supporting me. But what is the meaning if you're not choosing a right person for your front people? Right. They should have a vision, right? They should have a vision telling that community people, are supporting them, are giving some kind of relief for the people. That is not happening there. So for having a branding or some name, you want to have a community people, that's not a right thing in my vision. Like,
right.
If I'm answering your question,
yes,
that's what I really mean for it.
Yes, exactly. And I would just like to, for the benefit of our listeners, Cheyutha is a Telugu word which means helping hand. Am I right, Lakshmi?
100%.
Yes. So that is the helping hand your organization is giving to women who really need those helping hands and that support.
Women and children, madam.
Yeah, and children. Yes, of course. Yes, and children. So, anything else you would like to share, Lakshmi? You are free to say that. And I'm really very grateful for you, to you, for finding time today to have this conversation.
So, my thing is only, ma'am, I am requesting for an help. Now I'm seeking help for my organization, not to me. Organization in sense like I told them we don't need to get a project, we don't need to get a funding. We are having a sustainability project with us, Jute Enterprise. We are also capable in doing projects also. Why don't people recognize us? Why don't they give us uplifting? How many years Dr. Ranganath Rao sir will be helping us? And Azim Premjit, I should talk about Azim Premjit,
yes,
ma'am.
Yes.
Foundation. They have really, without knowing what is we did
yes.
not have so much of courage also to manage 1.32 lakhs project. But they have given me, they trusted us. And like those kind of our organizations, we are looking for us to support, madam. And if we get that kind of a support, madam, I can't assure you that 100% I'll do this, I'll do that. I'm telling that my best, what I can do to in the part of prevention or in part of saving on children who can live a better life.
Yes.
That much we can work for it, ma'am. Because myself, our team is also like the people who are now our board members, our staff member, our advisory people. Are the same kind of mentality people like how I look about this whole journey with HIV and what needs to be support for the women and children. So I think those kind of a support is required for us.
Right. And how many women are members of your organization? How many women do you
have? Now we have a size of 666, madam, where
okay.
we have a woman 398 and 175 children, and we
okay.
have a men also in our organization.
Huh. Okay.
But we provide them services, but we don't, they are not have a voting rights.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right.
They are not into our staff, they are not
mm-hmm.
into our board. So
yes.
our organization is completely for women and women
yes. Based
staff and mm. women board members. And
yes.
the services also will be to a large number of women and children only.
Right.
If she is saved, she can save her family and children.
Yeah, right. One woman can do lot many things. You are very right there. And thank you very much. Friends, we were listening to Kagitha Laxmi Priya, founding member of Cheyutha, women community-based organization, which is based in Hyderabad. Thank you very much, Lakshmi.
Thank you.